much noise as you possibly can, because our first guest left on the screen and into our hearts the moment she put down her upside down copy of the Quibbler. You know her as Luna, sorry, Luna Lovegood. Please welcome to the panel, Evanna. Next up, known as the twin brothers who had to dye their hair ginger for 10 years. We first met James and Oliver Phelps at King Cross Station as Fred and George Weasley. Ready to board the Hogwarts Express 13 years later, please join me in welcoming to stage James and Oliver Phelps. Next up, from exploding feathers to exploding water to exploding bridges, it's safe to say that our next guest character always brought a spark onto the screen. We all know him as Seamus Finnegan, Harry's friend and fellow Gryffindor. Please join me in welcoming to the stage, Devon! And last but not least, he's a herbology nut. He's a dance master. He's a wielder of the Sword of Gryffindor. We first met our next guest as he appeared on screen as a nervous, luckless newcomer, Neville Longbottom. But it didn't take long for his true Gryffindor colors to show, and his courage captured everyone's heart. Please welcome to our panel, Matthew Lewis! Ladies, welcome to the stage. How are you guys doing today?
Really good, thanks.
Warmer than yesterday? I know Matthew's warmer than yesterday.
Yeah, I was a bit cold yesterday. Got a cup of tea as well, keeping me warm.
There you go. That's good. Good to be prepared. Now, here's the deal, guys. This is your turn to ask questions to these guys you always wanted to know. And I'm going to explain to you how that's going to work. Now, we have people in the audience right now. We have Julia right there. Where's Jason at? Where's Jason? Jason's right here. We've got Aaron on this side. We've got Steven up on that side of the audience. We're going to be going to them to get your questions. So you want to find them right now. They're going to find you. They're going to get questions ready to go. And we're going to ask them up here. We're just going to go around in a circle. But I'm going to kick us off. I'm going to start this one. I'm actually going to throw this one to you. Let's see. How about, who's your favorite Harry Potter cast member to work with? Yeah, we're hitting you hard from the beginning. Remember who you're up here with.
I don't know. I really can't say. I love them all. And
nah. We want to know. We want to know. You've got to say. You've got to pick one.
It's true. You do have to pick one.
Yes.
I would definitely go with one of the four that's here right now. That's right, I'll let you go on that one. Just once, you get one. It's not me. What about two? What if you could pick two?
Yeah, two.
Oh, I said, all right. James, Oliver. I love that.
James.
Super easy. See? All right, we're going to throw this out to you guys. Jason, you got somebody out there?
Yep. We have Marissa from Orlando with a question for everyone.
So on Pottermore, there's a lot of really great background information that you don't get to read in the books. And I wanted to know if there's anything in Pottermore that really like grabbed your attention or surprised you.
Do you guys want to go down the line with that one? Just a quick answer.
I suppose McGonagall's backstory, that was really interesting. I know J.K. Rowling is a genius, she kind of covers everything, but I kind of think this is someone we're never going to find out about, and I don't know, it just made her a more sympathetic character to find out of her family's, her Muggle background and everything. So yeah, probably that. I love the character backstory. It's just, you reread them and you're like, oh, that's why she's such a, I don't know how to say it.
James.
I don't think they've even been sorted on Pottermore.
Uh-oh.
That is true. I've got to be honest, I have been sorted through the sorting hat at the exhibition, and I wasn't actually a Gryffindor.
What did you get sorted as?
I was a Hufflepuff.
I'm sure they're okay. Oliver, what about you, man?
I was a Gryffindor on that, but in terms of like the backstory and everything, it was quite cool for the character to see that like George kind of had like an existence outside of the friend of George scenario. Had to be really. So that's quite cool for Death character.
Devon?
Backstory, I'm not gonna lie, I never read it. There's no point lying to you all. So, yeah, but I have been sorted and I was a Slytherin.
Not as a spy this time, just...
No, not as a spy, unfortunately.
Matthew?
I haven't read it or been sorted either. So I don't even have an answer.
Same on you.
It's... Sorry. What do you think I'd be? Go on, Alan, come on. Hufflepuff.
They're claiming everybody now.
Hufflepuff. Alright.
Just be cool on with whatever. Alright, good question, Marissa. Julia, what do you got up there?
Alright, I have Lindsay from Orlando and she has a question for Matthew.
Really excited. If you could eat any magical food or drink from the wizarding world, what would it be?
Fire whiskey. I've always wanted to try that. And it's cold right now, so it'd probably help out.
Yeah, it'd be a perfect way to stay warm last night for sure. Good question. Steven!
I've got Michael from St. Cloud.
Before I ask this question, I'm just saying it's an honor to ask you guys a question because I'm a huge fan of you guys. But my question is, if you could choose a favorite scene from your movies, what would it be?
Does that ask for anybody specific or just...
All of them, sir.
Matthew, we're going to start with you.
Favorite scene? Is that to film or to shoot, do you reckon? To film or to watch, do you reckon?
We'll say to film.
To film. My favourite scene to film was probably blowing up the bridge stuff in Deathly Hallows Part 2. We had such a laugh, didn't we? We were on that bridge for such a long time. Doing all the stunts and stuff required for that out of Pinewood, and it was great because they built so much of it. I mean, you were halfway up the side when you're filming stuff, and
that's right. I was jumping from beam to beam, planting the charges to blow it up.
It was really cool. It was just like there's so much went into it, and when we actually finally finished it, we blew the bridge up, and there was kind of a total feeling of satisfaction and completion when we did it. It was really cool.
For me, it's not something that I had a big part in. It was actually when Neville stands up to Voldemort. And I just thought Matthew was doing an amazing job watching him grow from the very first movie up until the very last movie. And he just outshone. Like, he just completely nailed it. It's by far my favourite scene out of all the movies because Matthew just nailed it.
Oliver?
Mine was when Harry and Ginny first kiss. and it was awkward to film.
It was like Creeper in the corner.
Yeah. But it was really good to do because it was a really comical moment as well. And I've actually heard of people do that to friends who are kissing. It's going to be like, morning. really ruined the moment. And
you ruined it well. It was good.
Yeah, I enjoyed doing that.
James.
Mine would be, we actually, for you guys who were there last night, the scene where Fred and George put their names in the Goblet of Fire for the first time. It was just so much fun to do. I mean, that scene took 3 days to shoot. Yeah. But it was just really cool, really good fun. And since then, if I've been out and like at a bar, for example, there'll be these, it has happened on a couple of occasions, someone from the other side of the bar, like, oi, oi. And they do that thing where they put the arms around each other and drink like that. So. But that was a really, really fun scene, good fun scene to do. And we got to do some stunts as well in that. So yeah, really good.
Very nice. Fun.
I like the Bill and Fleur's wedding because it was just cool to see a wizard wedding, how that worked. And I always liked the scenes where there were lots of people and I wasn't really featured because it meant I could just go like I was just in the Harry Potter book and just play. And also the thing about the extras on Harry Potter, for that set especially, they got a lot of like older actors who had crazy beards, and those kind of guys who have 2 foot beards, they are kind of like wizards, even though they're muggles. They're always really interesting, so it was just funny, like, wandering around the set and talking to these would-be wizards in real life if they had magic powers. So
you're saying anybody with a long beard is pretty much a wizard?
Pretty cool, yeah, it's quite an achievement. And the dancing was fun. We got to do, like, the awkward dad dancing, but then Luna joins in, so it was fun.
Very nice. Now, Erin, you got somebody down there?
I do. This is Devon Nunez, who is our Hot Topic sweepstakes winner.
Okay, so my question is for all of you, and I wanted to know if you had total creative control over your character, regardless of what JK did after the books, how do you think you would have developed after the series ended? Your character.
I'll answer straight away.
Too soon?
I often think that, like,
maybe a rewrite. Yeah. Bring him back for his own series.
Like Weasley would become a franchise, and they'd have done that, and maybe the ghost of Fred. Spoiler to anybody that hasn't seen it.
You can bring the ghost back to consult on the store.
Yeah, like, perfect. You can be all over the shop. Yeah, that'd be great.
Devon?
I think Seamus would have went off in the pyrotechnics. for sure. Like, he was only going that way anyway. So, yeah, I think that's what Seamus would do, go off and blow up buildings and do whatever needed to be done.
Matthew?
It's tough. You know, when we completed Neville's story arc, I just thought it was so perfect and so nice the way that he evolved and became, you know, the herbology teacher at Hogwarts and all that kind of stuff. And is it Hannah Rabbit, I think, that he eventually settles down with? I thought she wrote such a great backstory for him and what he went on to do. And I don't know how much really I would have changed it, to be honest. I think I'm pretty content with that.
She said in the web chat that she goes on to be a naturalist, and I really like that because I really think Luna's connection with animals is very important because, you know, animals are so non-judgmental and they're so, they just be, and that's the way Luna is. She just bees herself. She doesn't worry about what anyone thinks, so I do like that. But I don't know about her getting married, because she gets married and I kind of think she's a bit too free-spirited and can't imagine her being tied down with kids. So, I don't know, maybe she'd start some sort of hippie cult and then lead them around for a few years and then leave. And she's just someone who doesn't stay attached very long.
It's like, a free spirit.
Yeah, she just explores.
Jason.
Hey, we've got Billy from West Palm Beach with a question for,
all right,
Evanna.
Hi, Evanna. Just wanted to say first that we really missed you at the Quidditch World Cup last year. And my question is, I know you're a huge Muggle Quidditch fan, and we're wondering if you're going to come back this year.
Muggle Quidditch?
Yep.
sure. I mean, I suck at it. I once got to, I wasn't even playing the game. I had to assist the Golden Snitch, and I just lost the game for him because he gave me this spray to spray into other people's face, and I'm just not that competitive, and I was also just so amazed by what all the whirling things that I ruined it, and I lost the game for him. Yeah, so
I'm sure they did.
But I'll stay way back to no one. I won't interfere with anyone.
Hey.
Are you on a team?
I play for the FSU team, Florida State University. Oh no!
What position are you?
I play mostly meter.
Good luck.
You.
Julia.
All right, I have Allie from Deltona, Florida.
I just want to say I love you guys, and I was wondering, what was it like to work with Alan Rickman?
Anyone? It's not a good start.
To be perfectly honest with you, he's one of the nicest guys you could ever wish to meet. He's quite obviously his voice is very intimidating, but he's a very, very funny man actually. And again, just like all the other adult actors, they're all very encouraging if you had a question, because pretty much all of us were learning as we did the job. So they're all very encouraging to go and ask them questions about how to prepare for a scene or deliver a line or whatever. But yeah, Alan Rickman was just one of those guys who's very, very nice and very great to work with.
Yeah, I think it goes without saying, we're all massive fans of his work and was before meeting him, to go to the rig through and see the Sheriff of Nottingham sat over, across the way, it was just a bit crazy. So yeah, a huge inspiration to me. And I remember on his last day of shooting, I just went down to his trailer just to say, the last 10 years, working with you was pretty incredible for me. And I really, really appreciate you being involved. And he was just like, come in, sit down, had a cup of tea, just like talking about the future, what to do next, and bit of advice and stuff. It was just, he didn't need to do that. It was just above and beyond, and that's, that's the kind of people we were fortunate enough to work with. They were all like that. So yeah, it was great.
Very nice. Steven.
Hey there, I have Alexandra from Kansas City, and she has a question for anyone on the panel that would like to answer.
Did J.K. Rowling ever tell you anything about your characters that has not been shared?
Sorry, could you repeat that?
Say one more time. Has J.K. ever told you, any of you, anything about your character individually that has not been shared with the world?
It's all pretty much out there.
She told me while she was writing book 7, she used to come to the set, and she knew how excited I would get when she gave little facts, so she would just tease me with things. But I remember the time she told me about Rolf Scamander, and this is the boy who Luna eventually marries, and she told me that he was supposed to be in book 7, and he was supposed to impart the information that Xenophilius does about the Death of the Hallows. And all through writing, we wrote letters. She was like, he's in, he's out, he's in, and he didn't make it in, but he was originally in book 7, she told me. And she also told me something about Luna, which I found really useful. It was on number 5, when we were in the Ministry of Magic, and we were fighting the Death Eaters, and just fighting. And Luna, like everyone else, is kind of afraid, anxious, and they're all, their the tension is high. And I couldn't figure out how Luna would be in that situation, because she's always so calm. She's like, everyone else is like, oh my god, the Dark Lord's here, and she's looking at the patterns on the ceiling, and she's not at all. So I was like, at the same time, David Yates was very much like, you need to be more afraid. You're in the Ministry of Magic with Voldemort and his gang. So, so I talked to Jo, and she said, well, actually, Luna, she is the most adjusted to death in the series, like even more than Dumbledore, so she's not worried about, like, death. She doesn't think that's the end, that's not final for her, but she does care so much about her friends, so she's worried for them. So yeah, that was interesting. It was useful. I thought it was just crazy because Dumbledore is someone who he seems like he doesn't care about death, but the fact that Luna is even more sort of spiritual than him, that was significant to me.
That's cool. Aaron.
Yes, Austin, I have little Jack here from Lake Mary, Florida with a question for the panel. Jack, what's your question?
Do you guys have any advice for a little actor like me?
How old are you?
10.
Well, that's the age that I first got cast in the movie, you know? So it's never too early to start. I would say, personally, if it's what you want to do, then just keep at it. You know, keep going and believe in yourself and don't listen to anyone else who says you can't do it. Just say, I want to do it, I'm going to do it. Good luck.
He's like, yeah. Anybody else?
Yeah, if you've got a script and you're going to learn your lines, just learn your lines. Like, I know it sounds silly, but it's quite easy to put it off, yeah, I'll do it tomorrow, I'll do it later. But nothing that you do whilst putting it off feels as good as actually doing it there and then. So yeah, just go for it.
And maybe like record yourself so that you can watch it back, so you can say, hang on, I don't like the way I'm doing that, I don't like how I'm doing that. So you can watch it as many times as you want, and then you'll also have, you can record, say your mum or your dad can read the other parts, and then you can listen to that and not record you, so that you can add in the parts that you want while you're listening to it in headphones and things like that.
All good advice. You got one? Yeah.
I just want to say, I think you're doing great already. Like the fact that you're so young and can stand up in front of all these people. I wouldn't have been able to do that at your age. So I would say just keep being yourself. You know, that is the most important thing, that preserve your essence. I don't want to sound pretentious, but like, actually that's, Alan Rickman, he said that to something to me, speaking of him, recently I met him. And I was having a crisis, and I was like, I should go to acting school, I don't know what I'm doing. And he just kind of was like, just be yourself. And he said, because they're looking at this, they're not looking at this, it's about what's inside. So I think you're already doing awesome. The fact that you have the confidence and yeah, good luck.
Now he's taking photos. He's already on his way. Jason.
I have Isabel from Fort Lauderdale, and she has a question for Matthew.
While you were filming, did you ever like learn any life lessons? And if so, then what were they?
Man.
Always trust the stuntmen implicitly. Never ignore anything that they say. You know, growing up on a film set, you know, starting 11, 10, 11 years old, working with adults on a daily basis, you learn a whole lot of things. I think James sort of touched on it earlier, you know, be as prepared as physically possible for everything you do. You know, there's no point turning up and doing things, you know, like a half job and doing things half measure. And we're really sort of encouraged to do that, and we were given the environment where we could do that and grow. And yeah, everyone I think put 110% into every scene, everything they could do. And I think that's one of the main things I've learned, is that if you can do 100%, then do it every single time, and you try and create the best you possibly can.
Absolutely. Nice question here.
I have Paul from New Jersey with a question for anyone on the panel that would like to answer.
What do you guys have most in common with your characters?
Being twins.
Nailed it.
I guess we do like to play practical jokes every so often, and
yes, he does.
Go ahead, tell him.
Last night I was returning to my hotel room, and I walked past Devon's hotel room, and Devon's hotel room had his breakfast card on the side. So instead of Devon having a light omelette, Devon had it.
I had absolutely everything in my illness.
Apparently the goat's milk couldn't be delivered in time, so...
And the bottle of vodka.
Going back to the question, we do like to play practical jokes every so often, and I guess it wasn't hard playing the cat, getting into character, shall we say. Nice. Aaron.
Next we have a fan question from Twitter.
Hi guys, this is from the Ask HP Cast hashtag. If you could have one sip of Polyjuice Potion, who would you want to be and why?
Anyone in the world. Anyone.
Anyone.
That was a good one. Can you tell we've never been asked this before?
I I'd love to have been a professional sportsman of some kind, so like David Beckham or something like that, and then go and have a kick about, pretend I'm David Beckham and be absolutely rubbish.
I'd probably do the thing Hermione does in Chamber of Secrets. She does it accidentally, but I would do the cat hair thing.
You would own it, though.
So it never changes. I'd probably not get any more acting roles, but... Or I'd get all of the fantasy roles, I mean, things or something. And then I would, like, play with it. I'd keep adding new animals, see how many different animals I could be at one time.
Difference is, you wouldn't stay in the same.
I thought she looked great as a cat.
Oh, James. I don't know, some superheroes, like maybe the Human Torch from Fantastic Four, that'd be pretty...
Flame on.
Exactly. Probably like Peyton Manning, like Miss Selection. But I wouldn't want to go back to Denver if anyone ever found out I wasn't actually him.
Are you saying he's not going to win?
No, I'm saying I would win.
Mine's kind of boring. I love show jumping, anything to do with horses, and one of my idols is Paul Darren, and he was just like, years ago he was like the best show jumping rider in all of Ireland and Europe, so that's probably who I'd like to be, just so I can go off and be as good as him. Sorry it's not interesting, and probably nobody knows who he is, but...
As long as you do, that's all that matters. Jason.
Hey, we've got Anna from Toronto with a question for Evanna.
Hi, so being a fan of the book series, what was it like when you first met J.K. Rowling?
Oh my god, that was a moment. It was such a surreal moment. It was already surreal because I'd been writing to her for a while, and she said she was going to come to set, but she didn't say when, so it was a big surprise, and it was a day we were just filming, I don't know what scene. But at the moment that she came in, Tom Felton had got me signing a book, and I was very new to it then, and in my head I was still like, wow, I'm signing an autograph for Draco Malfoy. Really, it was like finding that super cool. And then, this really attractive blonde lady walked in, followed by producers, and I was kind of like, oh. And I didn't clock it was her at first, because it just, why would it be? I just didn't think it would. But I knew because the producers were there, I was like, this must be someone important. And then like 5 seconds later it hit and I was like, I just freaked out. It just was incredible because she's such a warm and like, generous person, and she's one of those people who gives you all her time and all her attention whenever she's with you. And then you think, wait, this woman created all this, everything that's around us and everything that I've been sort of dreaming about and thinking about for the past years. And the fact that it's all contained in one small person is just mind-blowing. And the fact that she's as nice and sweet and amazing as she is. Yeah, it was amazing.
Julia.
Yes, I have Jeanette with me from Vineland, New Jersey, and her question is for Oliver.
Last night, James told us about how he felt when he found out his character was going to die. How did you feel when you had to film the scene when your brother dies?
Better than Fred felt. It was different. It was really different, because at first I thought it would be a closed set, being such an intimate moment, but as we see in the film, it pans back from the Great Hall and all the carnage was unfolded, and you see the death, the injured, and the pretty much everything. Right, we're done for him. And it was weird, like getting to an emotional point, and then having eucalyptus spray in my face to try and like get tears and everything. But you know, we did about 3 or 4 takes, which is enough really. I think the fact that I had to cry in front of a room full of people, that was probably the weirdest bit. But since then, I've always had things almost weekly sent through to me on Twitter. It's such a huge paragraph of someone's conjured up saying that how we hugged each other at the end and said we loved each other and that it'll never be the same again and all nonsense. Realistically, they didn't tell me we'd cut, so I stayed there just lying there. We went to lunch. They went to lunch and I kind of just, I opened my eye and then realised there's no one else on the stage. So, I mean, it was a different type of thing. But the weirdest point though was like the next week when we were filming the exterior shots with Voldemort in the courtyard when Matt stands up to him when James wasn't there. That was the weird bit for me. That was the moment of time when he came into it. Okay.
Of the day, it's going to be from Brianna from Georgia.
If you could pick one spell to use every day, what would it be?
One spell to use every day, what would it be? Lumos. I actually hit my, you get out of bed and you step on a plug which is upside down. That's one. If my one was there, I could lie and see what I was doing. Yeah.
I probably pick Expecto Patronum because I don't know, it just gives you a little lift, and I'd like a little animal galloping around me.
Cat?
Probably. although I don't think we're squirrels at the moment, so right now I'd like a squirrel.
Use both.
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie, I'm not going to use any spells. Everything would just go wrong.
Always with the explosions.
Yep. Stay away.
I think I'd like Amora, because I'm always getting locked out of my house. It would definitely save any embarrassment when the neighbour comes over and says, "Mr. Key again, huh?" That'd be really helpful.
Yeah, that's a good one. I drive a lot and I get road rage a lot. And there's so many times on the road, like Evanna Cadaver would just come straight.
And you got a dragon too, so I mean.
Seriously, people need to stop messing with me on the road. Like, dragon, it's coming out.
It's dangerous. See, I just imagine you doing that, pulling into your house with the dragon on the roof.
What a day, man.
That'd be awesome.
All right, man, that is all the questions that we have time for now. Guys, thank you very much. You guys are awesome.